Hey, hi everybody. This is Abhishek, and I represent Head Start Pune chapter. And today we are recording this session of Hustler Stories, wherein we bring you some exciting startup, and we get to talk to their founders and learn about how they are scaling their startups. So today we have Sahil with us. Sahil is a co-founder and CEO of Gig India. Gig India, what it is, Gig India is a marketplace that provides an on-demand work completion for companies through a gig workforce of job seekers. So they leverage technology like machine learning and artificial intelligence to provide good quality of work faster to the organizations. Welcome, Sahil. Welcome to Hustler Stories.
Thank you so much, Abhishek.
So, to start with, can you tell a little bit about yourself and your founders?
Sure. I'm Sahil. I run Gig India along with Aditya, which is my co-founder. We both started right out of college. We both love football. We both Manchester United fans, but the taste in music is very different. He likes all the weird bands and weird music. I'm more of a the music which is usually loved by everyone else is what is loved by me. So I'm that kind of a guy. On the business front, we both met in college. We solved several problems, but eventually we landed up on this problem which we are currently solving. And since then, it's been 3 years. That we've been building the business. Happy to talk about it. Happy to share whatever learnings we've had so far.
Yeah. So can you help us understand what triggered Gig India? Since you said that you were in college and this idea started.
Right. So very interesting story that way, Abhishek. When we were in final year, me and Aditya, we both graduates of computer science from PICT, which is in Pune. It's a computer science engineering college. When we were in final year, most of our friends were like a bit, you know, tensed whether if they're going to make it to a nice, good job or not, right? And one way they thought they could have an advantage over everybody else in the college was to have an additional experience, additional work experience. However, the problem at that point was that our college was at the other end of the city and most companies were, you know, at completely a different end of the city. So, and Pune, as we all know, has a bit, it's a traffic heavy city, right? So it's impossible for anybody to travel, like say 4 hours of travel time to just gain some industrial experience. So at that time we thought, hey, is it possible for us to just build a platform for our friends to get remote work access opportunities by these large organizations, gain experience, and then apply for full-time jobs. And that's how we launched Gig India. Over the past 3 years, we've matured as a business. On the supply side, we're not just now focused on students. We are adding job seekers, homemakers, retired professionals to get access to meaningful employment opportunities. They can, with the comfort of their home, they can work remotely for organizations. So that's what we've been doing. On the demand side, we work with large corporate businesses who have large scale requirements. So that's what we've been doing at Gig India.
Yeah. So can you help the people understand what Gig India actually does for businesses and for them in a layman's language?
All right. So in a very simple language, we say that, hey, we make lives easier for managers who especially have large teams to drive results, right? As a manager, imagine you have a large team. First, you have to recruit the team. So there's an overhead of recruiting the right people, then managing them, then managing the attrition, ensuring their right SOPs so that quality is of high standard. So there's a lot of overhead of really managing a large team to drive results. As Gig India, we are offering an alternative to those managers where they can transfer that entire overhead to us, where we take the entire end-to-end management of the workforce, drive results, right? The best part is that as a manager, I no longer have any overhead. I just have to sit back, relax, and give a clear mandate of what exactly work is required. Then we take that work, break it down into small minute tasks, which we call them as gigs, and distribute it to a large gig workforce that we have on our platform, which is Gig India. Once a gig worker completes tasks, or you know, regularly keeps completing their tasks day in, day out, keeps getting paid for the successful work that they've done. So on the business side, the entire cost becomes variable. And on the gig worker side, which is our giggers, they get to earn and also gain experience, right? So that is how we work. We connect the both.
Okay, great. And what is, how did you validate your idea while you were in college?
I think for us, validation happened very naturally. Not that as soon as we launched Gig India in August 2017, things started to work out, right? We took about, say, a year and a half or close to 2 years to eventually figure out what is really working. So earlier, we were working only for the student community. We were also working with small startups as our customers. And over the past 2 years, we've realized that what is the right first, right kind of demand, second, the right kind of supply, and third, what kind of tech platform can really drive the entire transaction between a gig worker and a corporate. So we've had fair share of learnings on these three aspects, which is demand, supply, and technology. Once we've had that, we built a platform which we've launched about a year and a half back, and that's when business really started to shoot up. So yeah, we've had fair learnings. I think it's same for every startup which is trying to do something new. You start out to do something, but by the end of 3 years, you're doing completely something else, right? That's common for all startups because you want to understand what the market is saying. And we are constantly hearing what market is saying and making changes at our end.
Correct. So you mentioned like you have around 750,000 users on your platform, gig workers.
Right.
How do you manage to get those in like just 3 years?
Right. So in the last 3 years, we have about 750,000, which is 7.5 lakh gig workers on our platform. Most of this, has come through organic traffic. We have a website where people apply for different kinds of job roles that we have to offer. Secondly, we've built some very qualitative partnerships with large organizations, be it government, be it educational institutions, or even NGOs for that matter, to supply us with curated workforce who is especially the ones who are ready to work remotely and get a paper result kind of a incentive. So with these partnerships, with organic traffic, with word of mouth, we've been able to get this large registration on a platform.
Correct. And is there any impact on your business because of COVID, since people are working from home, they get more, either there are less jobs, again, a lot of layoffs are happening. How Gig India is supporting them? Is there any way?
Right. So similar to almost every other business in the world, of course, we've had some impact due to the coronavirus. However, probably we are a bit fortunate that we've not just had the negative impact, but also a positive one. On the negative impact, of course, whatever field work we had, where our gig workers used to go on field and do the work, has stopped, right? Because you're now under lockdown, you can't really go on field and work. But at the same time, what has also worked for us is that large corporates, like traditional businesses, who probably would not have thought about, gig model, say for the at least next 20, 30 years, have now started thinking about how their entire workforce can get variabilized, at least in, at the lower levels of hierarchy, or say entry-level jobs or gray-collar skill jobs. So those corporates are now discussing with us, reaching out to us that, hey, how can Gig India help us variabilize a particular set of gig workers that they have? So that has worked better for us. So the adoption of the model itself across businesses has increased. That is what we've noticed. But yeah, on the negative side, we've lost our field requirement. But I think now with lockdown gradually, you know, opening up, things are opening up. So we are resuming our field work. So almost back to where we were before this happened.
Correct. And since your start, just in 3 years, you have raised three rounds of funding.
Right.
So how did that happen? And how has been the journey so far?
All right. So I think in our fundraising journey, we've been very lucky and fortunate to have been connected with some really good and helpful entrepreneurs. We raised a first round, which was made one of our entrepreneur friends helped us connect with their investors. We raised our second round because another entrepreneur connected us with somebody they had invest, you know, had investors. And third round, again, we were connected by somebody, right? So I think we've never, other than myself, had this very clear upfront that we are not going to chase investors, right? And we've never done that even till today. All the investor interest that we've received so far has been inbound. And I think that's how really VCs or say investors work, right? They go after good opportunities. So what we focus is on creating an opportunity attractive enough for somebody to reach out to us. That's what we are focusing on the fundraising part. It's not easy. We've learned, we've got a lot of no's as well. We've got three yeses so far, three rounds, right? But we've got a lot of rejections, a lot of no's. But I think it has to do more with how different people perceive different business models. Every investor has their own perspective of different businesses. You really eventually end up with investors who have the same thesis as you about your own business model. So it takes some time to find those kind of investors, but once you really find them, it's an instant hit, right? So we've been fortunate that way to find such investors backing us so far.
Great. Sahil, can you name some of the investors that you have and some of the marquee customers that you are currently serving?
All right, sure. So on the investor side, we have some marquee angels as a part of our angel group, right? Mr. S. Ramadurai, who was former CEO of TCS, is one of the investors. Mr. Kiran Deshpande, former CEO of Tech Mahindra, is an investor. Mr. Ravi Nigam, former MD and founder at Tasty Bite Eatables, is an investor. Mr. Shashank Deshpande, founder of Clarys Technologies, then later CDO at Globant, is an investor. In the latest round, we got Shantanu Deshpande, who is currently CEO of Bombay Shaving Company, as an investor. Sakshi Gudwani, who is a program officer at Bill and Gates Foundation, is an investor. So we've had some really, really amazing investors backing us. And of course, these are all the angel investors, but recently the pre-Series A round that we've raised in July has come from two VC investors from Japan. So one is Beyond Next Ventures, and the entire round was led by Incubate Fund India. So that's our investor base right now.
And some of your customer bases currently that you're serving?
Right. So I cannot reveal exact names. We have certain logos on the website. I think that's a clear indicator. Amazon is one of our largest customers. We work with the Reliance Group and several other companies, like say Swiggy is one of our customers. So there are a lot of other companies that we work with. But the whole concept is to work with large organizations where managers really lead larger teams. That is where we typically get in.
Great. And what kind of competition do you face for Gig India in India and outside?
Right. So I think the problem that we are today trying to solve has been there for a long time, right? Say, for example, outsourcing as an industry has been there for a long time, where, you know, the problem that they're trying to solve is that, hey, you have overhead of in-house team, you probably just transfer it back to some third party organization, right? But the way this problem has been solved so far has been very people driven, right? Where it doesn't really save a lot of costs. It does save overhead, but it probably adds on as a cost, right? What we are trying to do is bring in technology to solve the entire same problem, which does not just offer the transfer of overhead, but also helps businesses optimize their cost of operations and also scale faster and effectively. What we've noticed is that with existing alternatives in the market, be it domestic or be it global, each organization has a very limited scope of, say, either services or the geographies there where they can really serve their customers. As for Gig India, since we are doing it all through tech, those limitations are off, right? If in case we want to work with a company in Israel, we can do it. If you want to work with company, say, in US, we can do it. If you want to work with company in Vietnam, we can do it. So I think even our supply is not coming to an office like traditional BPOs or outsourcing agencies where they really the supply comes to a physical space to do some work. Since this entire thing is driven by technology, the customers give their work remotely, the gig workers do their work remotely. So that helps us really optimize the cost. Secondly, what we've realized is that the quality of work has been an issue with traditional outsourcing alternatives. Quality is never standardized. It's always so subjective. Nobody has been able to really standardize the quality of output or, you know, say that, hey, I'm only going to charge you by results that I deliver. That is what Gig India is doing. We are only charging our customers by the results that we drive for them and not for the workforce deployed. So all these traditional BPOs or say any other organization which is has taken up an outsourcing project charges the businesses per seat. But whereas Gig India, we're only charging by the results while we are offering cost optimization, while we are also providing better gig workers with the right quality standards. So overall, it's a good value proposition for a business.
Definitely. So cost saving is something which everybody are looking for, and results is what matters.
Right. Exactly. That's you've put it so accurately.
Yes. So Sahil, what are your plans for the next 12 to 24 months?
Right. So Abhishek, we have very simple goals. We don't like to keep very complex goals for ourselves. On the demand side, we want to grow our customer base by at least 5 times. On the supply side, we want to grow our customer base, our supplier base by at least 10 times. And on our technology side, the cost that we are incurring today, we want to reduce that. Our internal cost of serving our customers, we want to reduce that by 3 times, right? So these are very three simple goals that we have as an organization. So that's what we want to achieve.
Do you wish to plan to move outside of India as well?
Right. So like our name suggests, currently Gig India, we are built in India, made for India. But what we are realizing, in fact, from the inquiries that we are getting, there's a lot of global interest in the Indian supply, right? There's a lot of global demand which needs an Indian supply, right? So there's a big, big opportunity there. A lot of different companies are trying to cater to that demand in different ways. And the one that we are going after, the niche, hope we can leverage this new trend, right? So of course we have plans to see if we can get some global demand for Indian supply.
Great. So it was great to know, Sahil, about you, about Gig India, and thank you for being here with us.
Same here. Thank you so much, Abhishek.
Thank you so much.